So the next topic in this reading is going to cover these: the legal, regulatory and tax considerations. And this also is very important both from the point of view of the issuer as well as a bondholder. Okay, and here we are looking to cover bond indentures and types of bonds. These are the key elements that are present in a bond indenture, and we will be discussing each of these in details. And basis legal, regulatory and tax considerations, issuers can issue certain types of bonds. These can be euro bonds, foreign bonds and domestic bonds, which also we will discuss in detail. Right now, if you remember, we had said that a bond is a contractual agreement between the issuer and the bondholder. Right now, what is this legal document called? Right, so this legal document is called the bond indenture or the trust deed. Okay, so it's known by two words: bond indenture or the trust deed. And this is the legal contract that describes all the aspects of a bond. So what is the form of the bond, what is the obligation of the issuer, what is the right of the bondholder. And other than that, it also covers the financial aspects of the bond, such as where has the bond been issued, what is the principal value for each bond, what is the interest or coupon rate, the dates when interest principals will be made, what is the maturity date of the bond, and if there are any contingent provisions in the bond. Right, so the bond indenture is essentially a very comprehensive document that describes the rights of the bondholders, the legal obligations of the issuer, and all possible aspects related to that bond issue. Okay, and before we come to each of these issues separately, you know, such as your identity, source of repayment, I'm quickly going to spend a couple of minutes to describe what the curriculum spends some time on: trustee. Okay, so typically when a company wants to issue a bond, there could be, say, a company like General Electric that is raising, say, $500 million in terms of bonds. Now, of course, it might be difficult to get a single investor who might subscribe to these bonds, and typically there would be, say, thousands of investors. Now, do you think it would be practical for General Electric to enter into a direct agreement with each of these bondholders? So no. So in that case, the issuing company appoints this trustee. So this issuing company appoints the trustee. Okay, and this trustee acts in the interest of the bondholders. More legally said, they act in the fiduciary capacity of the bondholders. So their role is to ensure that the issuer complies to all its obligations specified in this indenture. Okay, so it is essentially a body which has oversight over all the activities with respect to the bond issue. Right now, their duties are quite wide, and largely it is said that their duties are administrative. So they are responsible for keeping the track of coupon payments and making sure that it is credited to the bondholders' accounts. They also appraise the collateral that is offered as a security against the bond issues. They are also responsible, for calling the meetings for bondholders and discussing any actions to take in case there is a default on behalf of the, in case any default by the issuer of the bonds. So essentially, the key point you have to remember here is that this entity or this trustee is appointed by the issuer but acts in the interest of the bondholders, it's basically a easier way for the issuer to hand over all the administrative tasks with respect to the bond issue to another party. Yeah, so just keep that in mind. Now we are going to talk about each of the aspects of a bond issue and each of the elements that are covered in the bond indenture. So first we come to the identity of the issuer. Now you remember that we had broken down the issuers of bond into three categories: government and government sponsored entities, the corporates, and we had structured finance, right? So in case for government and government sponsored entities, typically the legal issuer, in case say a country like the UK is issuing the bond, the legal issuer is usually the office that is responsible for managing the national budget. So in case of the United Kingdom, you have Her Majesty's Treasury. So that is responsible for managing the national budget, but the bond is actually issued by an executive agency such as the Debt Management Office, right? So government sponsored entities, the central government finance division is responsible for managing the national budget, and through its executive arm it issues bonds and raises money to meet its budgetary requirements. Now corporates, and in this I will have to state a couple of important points. Now corporates are typically, you know, bonds issued by corporates are typically in their name. So for example, if you know Volkswagen decides to issue a bond, so the issue will clearly state that Volkswagen AG has issued the bonds. Now there's a lot of times where these companies or these big multinational companies raise money in multiple countries at the local level through their subsidiaries. In that case, it is very important for the subscriber of the bond to see whether the subsidiary of say Volkswagen is capable of paying the bond. One, that is very important, has to ensure or has to check, the investor has to check if the subsidiary is capable of honoring its commitments of interest and principal payments. Second, it's very important for the investor to also see that if the obligations of the local subsidiary that is raising the capital, whether these obligations are also backed by the parent company. So if Volkswagen, say Brazil, for example, is raising bonds, it will be important and for the investor to go through the bond indenture and see whether these principal and interest obligations are also backed by Volkswagen Germany. Now, generally, this is not always the case, since subsidiaries are always rated lower than their parent in most cases. And it's in very, very, very rare cases that local subsidiaries of a multinational company are rated higher than the parent company itself. Right? Just keep these two things in mind. And the structured finance sector, again, this is a separate topic and we will discuss this later. But in case of structured finance, as we discussed, it is typically the SPV which is issuing the bonds on behalf of the issuing company that is wanting to raise money. And the assets are already securitized in that SPV, ensuring that there is a recourse to the assets of that company for the investors in case of default, right? Okay, now source of repayment proceeds, and again we are going to discuss this with respect to the three types of issuers of the bond. So you have government and government sponsored entities, corporates and structured finance. Now assuming that you are, say, the government of the United States and you have issued the bond, your ability to repay is typically a function of two key powers that you have. One is your power to raise taxes. So you issue bonds, you need to repay those bonds. One of the ways, though unfair to its citizens, would be to raise taxes to help issue bonds. And the second option is print money. So the sovereign government can, so the central government can repay using either taxes and print money. So these are the two ways, right? So we also have state governments issuing bonds, and state governments or local governments can be repaid again using the taxing authority of the issuer. So if the state of Minnesota, for example, raises taxes for a particular year or for a few years, that will primarily to pay back certain amount of debt which it had raised. Now it's also possible, as I've discussed earlier, a state government may raise funds to finance specific projects. So it can use the cash flow from these projects to pay off the interest and principal payment on the bond. And though rare, there is another way in which they can raise money, and that is in the form of special taxes or fees. And though this is very rare and is typically used only in times of necessity or emergency, the state government is in a position to raise specified charges or taxes or fees to help repay the bonds. Now, corporates. So, corporates typically repay the bonds via their ability to generate cash flows through their operations. Now, these cash flows of the issuer typically determine the financial strength of the issuer, and this is very important because a corporate bond is always more risky or always has more credit risk than a sovereign bond, and hence in a lot of these cases corporates typically set aside some form of collateral or security, which we will discuss next, as a security. They set aside some assets that they have. So it could be, say, their plant and machinery, it could be land, or it could be, say, other financial assets. They set that aside as a security in case they are unable to pay, right? Yeah. And structured finance. Now, depending on the type of the structure or the way in which the manner in which the funds have been raised, it is important that the investor pays very important attention to the assets that have been transferred to the SPV by the issuing entity. So if I can go up to this slide, now you see Company A transfers the assets as a security to this SPV. So as an investor, you would always be wary about whether this asset, right, whether this asset, highlighted in green, is the quality of the asset is good, and when it is sold, whether it is capable of generating the proceeds from the sale is sufficient to cover the interest and principal payments of the investor. Two, in a lot of cases, investors will also want to see whether these assets are liquid, whether they can be sold very fast. So there are a lot of factors in case of structured finance sector which the investors look at, of which the asset quality is the most important. Okay, now we'll come to the next part that will be stated in indenture, and very important is the collateral backing of these bonds which are issued. Now you as an investor, if you are subscribing to a bond, you would always be worried that if the investor cannot pay, what do I do? If the issuer cannot pay, what do I do? So to provide comfort to the investor, the issuer will typically provide a security, also known as a collateral. And in case the company is unable to pay the interest and principal, this collateral can be used by the investor to sell. This collateral can be sold by the investor, and the proceeds from it can be used to receive the payments that were originally supposed to be received. Note, it is important to mention that sometimes the collateral, or in most cases, the collateral is higher than the amount lent. So if, say, the issuer has raised 100 million, for example, from the bond issue, it may have to provide security or collateral to the extent of, say, 200 million, depending on the quality of the issuer. Okay, so basis this, there are three types of collaterals that are typically offered. One is a collateral trust bond. Now, collateral trust bonds are secured by, you know, securities such as equity, you know, other bonds, or any financial asset, essentially. It's a very common way of securing your, it's a very common way of providing collateral. In fact, promoters of a lot of companies, when they raise money, especially if the companies are publicly listed, they pledge or they provide their own shares, their stake in their shares. So if a promoter owns, say, 25% of a company, right, and he issues bonds, he may provide 25% of the shares that he owns in the company as a collateral, right? So equipment trust certificates are also bonds that are backed by very specific types of equipments, you know, such as aircrafts, could be shipping containers, could be oil vessels, oil rigs. So the most common example is again an airline industry. So if you assume that an airline finances the purchase of a new aircraft with equipment trust certificates, what this means is that the legal title of the new aircraft that are going to be purchased are going to be held with the trustee, right? You remember the trustee, the middleman who acts in the interest of the bondholders, right? So the legal title of this aircraft is going to be held with the trustees, and the trustee instead, the trustee after that, leases the airlines, or rather leases the planes or the aircraft to the airline. The airline keeps making the lease payments and the interest payments on these certificates, and once the certificate matures, or once these bonds mature, the trustee sells the aircraft to these airlines and uses the proceeds from this sale to retire the principal and cancels the lease. So this is typically known as sale and leaseback, and this again is will be covered later. But essentially, most important thing to keep in mind is that equipment trust certificates, backing collateral or equipments, these are typically the underlying assets which are used by the issuer for his day-to-day operations. Now, a covered bond is essentially a debt obligation that is backed by a pool of assets, right? And these pool of assets are separate from the other assets of the issuer, right? Now, if you remember this SPV structure that we have discussed earlier, we see that the company has to transfer the assets to the SPV, right? And that is where it is securitized. In this case, the company does not have to make any transfers to any SPV. So the assets are held on the issuer's balance sheet. And these assets are specifically held only for the bonds against which these bonds have been issued, right? So you could not have any other creditor, theoretically speaking, you cannot have any other creditor claiming anything on these assets except those creditors against, you know, those creditors against whom these bonds have been issued, backed by these assets. Okay, so there are a lot of instances when assets in the covered pool become non-operating. So in that case, the issuer is obligated to replace these assets with a performing asset. So that in case of recourse for the bondholder, the value of the collateral remains the same, right? So these are covered bonds. Key points to remember is, unlike structured finance where these bonds are transferred to another SPV, these assets are transferred to another SPV, in case of covered bonds, these assets are not transferred to another SPV. They are held on the balance sheet, but they are kept segregated or separate from other claims. These assets are for those bondholders who have been issued bonds backed by these specific assets only, right? And typically issuers have to replace these assets once in a while as assets become non-performing and their value depreciates over time. Now, there is two topics of debentures and secured bonds, which I'm going to cover in the next slide. So I'm just going to erase these. Okay, can't. Right. So continuing with bond indenture, another area that the indenture will typically cover would include covenants. Now, what are covenants? Now, covenants are important. They are legally enforceable rules that the issuer must adhere to. Now, these are agreed at the time of the bond issue, and these covenants have to be acceptable to both the issuer as well as the investors in these bonds. And that is why there are two types of covenants. You have affirmative covenants and negative covenants. So typically these are what we will focus more on, negative covenants. Affirmative covenants are very administrative in nature, and they essentially tell the company very basic housekeeping things. So it could include things like, you know, the company must pay taxes. I mean, all companies must pay taxes, right? So the company must pay taxes, the company must maintain its assets, and other such basic housekeeping requirements. Now, the very important thing about affirmative covenants is that they are not too costly to impose, right? They are not costly. And costly in the sense, it will not be financially costly. and it would not affect the decision of the senior management to run the operations of the company. Okay, so this is what an affirmative covenant is. Now, a negative covenant, and this is what we'll focus on, is essentially a long list of what the issuer is not allowed to do. So it could be a lot of things. So it could include, now these are negative in nature, and it includes all those activities which could be costly, plus materially affect the issuer's operations. That's right. So for example, it could say that the total debt of the company cannot exceed, say, you know, as a percentage of ratio, the total debt to equity of a company cannot be greater than, say, 0.75. the company, or that the company is not allowed to raise additional debt. It could also include issuance of debt that would be senior to the current existing debt. It could also restrict dividends to shareholders or any other payments to shareholders, for example, buybacks. It could put a restriction on sale of assets. It could also restrict investments in other financial securities. So basically, it's a long laundry list of whatever things the company is not allowed to do. And typically, this is done by the bondholders to protect themselves from a lot of issues such as dilution. So dilution of claims. So if a company issues more senior debt, the existing bondholders would be second in line to repayment. It could also prevent the company from making risky investments to protect the company's operations and cash flows. It could help to prevent devaluation of the business. So negative covenants are basically done or issued by bondholders to protect their own interests. And the main characteristics, the entire underlying theme that you will be seeing on negative covenants, is that the issuer will be prevented from taking any action that could affect its ability to be repaid. And that is the most critical point. Negative covenants are restrictive, and the entire intention is that they that the issuer should not take any action that would affect the ability for the issuer to make interest and principal payment to bondholders. Now, there are a lot of pluses and minuses to this. If the global economy is already in a negative, or if the global economy, as in the current situation, is not growing very healthy and companies are facing financial distress, putting additional negative covenants could potentially push the company to, default on payments. So it actually encourages defaulting. It does encourage companies to default. Second, to some extent, using these negative covenants, there is an implication that bondholders are indirectly affecting the operations of a business and or are running it in the background. So just keep these things in mind that a negative covenant essentially does everything it can to protect the bondholders from default in the company. The bondholders will issue these to protect their interests and receive their interest and principal payments. And there could be a lot of ways in which they can do this, and we've discussed some of these here. Negative covenants also can have a negative impact on the operations of a business and would imply that bondholders are running the business in the background. And in case the company is already not in a good financial position, imposition of other negative covenants would affect the ability for the business to run optimally or run at all, and could lead to bankruptcy.